Hey guys, it's Courtney. Today we are going to talk about a pretty old case. We're talking about Sherry Lynn Marler, who disappeared back on June 6th of 1984 from Greenville, Alabama. Now for the coloring, I'm going to be using Pick of the Patch stamp set, which I'm going to obviously make a slimline card. And this is by Trinity Stamps. It is being released today. As you can see, there's probably going to be, there is some repetitive coloring here. So I'm going to skip through some of it. I'll show you all the color combinations and things like that, but I'm not going to show you the entire card just because it gets a little repetitive. So let's talk about Sherry Lynn Marler. She was 12 years old at the time she disappeared. She was very close to her family, who described her as a really good kid. She was a little bit of a tomboy, and she loved farming. So the night, or the morning, I should say, of June 6th, 1984, Sherry's mom, Betty, left for work pretty early. Sherry was still sleeping at the time. Her mom worked at the Waffle House. So it was just her stepfather, Raymond, and Sherry at the house, and Raymond had planned on running some errands that day. Sherry asked to go with him. Of course, he said yes. So they were out and about that morning. One of the stops that Raymond had to make was at the First National Bank. He had some paperwork to sign. So he pulled up outside of the bank. It was street parking. He gave Sherry $1 to walk across the street and get herself a soda at the Chevron station. Raymond was in the bank for about 15 minutes, came back out to the truck, and expected Sherry to either be in the truck or standing somewhere around the truck waiting to go home, and Sherry was nowhere to be found. At first, Raymond didn't think anything of it. He went across the street to the Chevron station. Maybe Sherry had run into some friends that she was talking to or whatever, and he went across the street and she was not there. He asked some people that he saw if they had seen her, and of course they said no. He immediately called Betty at work at the Waffle House, thinking that maybe Sherry had walked down to her mom's job to visit her for a little bit, and Betty had claimed that Sherry had never shown up. So they checked with local businesses who said that they didn't see Sherry, but later on in the investigation, they did confirm that they saw her cross the street to the Chevron station, but they didn't see her again after that. Sherry was officially reported missing to the police at 11:46 that morning. Now, it's not uncommon for police to assume or to at least question the possibility of a young girl, young teenager, preteens, whether or not they ran away. So very briefly, this was a possibility, but the family confirmed and was adamant that she would never run away. She was very close to all of her family members. She had plans to visit her grandmother later on that day, and she was really excited about doing that. She didn't have any of her belongings with her. They were all left at home. So the possibility of her running away was pretty much eliminated right off the bat. Now, Raymond obviously was the last person to see Sherry. She was in his care at the time that she disappeared. So he was interrogated quite a bit. The authorities to this day claim that he was never a suspect, but obviously him being the last person to see her, that's the first person that they're going to interrogate. He did refuse to take a polygraph test, which a lot of people assume guilt when people do this. However, I watch a lot of true crime stuff, guys, and polygraphs are not 100% accurate. That's why they're not even used in trials. They can't be used as evidence. So the fact that he refused to take a polygraph test does not mean he was guilty of anything. In fact, he carried a lot of guilt throughout his entire life. He passed away not too long ago, well, several years after Sherry disappeared. And right up until the day he died, he expressed how guilty he felt for not knowing where she went when she was in his care. So Raymond is ruled out at this point, and so is the possibility of Sherry running away. So that really only leaves two options: Sherry being kidnapped by a stranger or Sherry being kidnapped by someone she may have known. Now, the stranger idea or theory could be a possibility, because there were three unconfirmed sightings of Sherry, not in Greenville. There was one in New Orleans, there was one about 2 hours away from Greenville, and they were sightings from three different people who all described the same man that this girl was with. He was described to be in his 50s. He was about 5'8" with a husky build, weathered skin, and he possibly might be named BJ. One of the witnesses said that she heard the girl call this man BJ. It is kind of weird that all three witnesses described this same man, but unfortunately, they are unconfirmed. They did all report that the girl, whoever this girl may have been, did appear to be scared and upset. After that, there were no more sightings of Sherry and really no more evidence. Now, the other theory is that she was kidnapped or possibly murdered by someone that she knew. About a year before Sherry disappeared, she did spend some time visiting her stepsister and her stepsister's husband, and authorities did receive a tip that Sherry was spotted in that area shortly after she disappeared. Again, this is unconfirmed, but one of the theories is that she was either kidnapped by somebody she knew or she was trying to get to some place where she felt safe with someone she knew. So again, unconfirmed, no evidence to support this was even true. Now, there is pretty much a Facebook group for any missing person out there. It's a good way to get new information out there. It's a good way to receive new information about missing person cases or cold cases or anything like that. So it's not unusual to have a Facebook group for missing persons cases. And Sherry Lynn Marler is no different. There is a Facebook group out there to kind of keep the word out there about her disappearance. And in 2019, there was a post by a woman named Ryan Welch Anderson. She claims to be kind of like an independent investigator. And what I mean by that is she does not work for the police department. She's not a private investigator. She kind of just researches things on her own. Now, she created a post in this Facebook group that claimed that Sherry was murdered by someone she knew, and it was not Raymond. Her body was thrown into a hog pen on a pig farm that was confirmed to be operating at the time of Sherry's disappearance. She also claims that Sherry was pregnant at the time as a result of incest, and the people responsible for her kidnapping and murder is now deceased, and there was more than one person. Now, there was also a picture that was circulating, which I'm not going to post here. You can easily find it on the internet if you want to see it. Now, mind you, this picture was taken in 1984. The quality of the photo is not great, but it is of a hog pen or a pig pen, and there's clearly a pig in it, but there is something else in there that many people believe, is a head. Now, this would support the theory that Sherry was thrown into the pig pen, but it is not confirmed. Apparently, and there's multiple stories about this, whether we don't really know what's true at this point, but apparently this photo was turned over to the FBI along with some fabric that was found on this pig farm, or what used to be a pig farm, that they believed may have been Sherry's clothing. Now, from what I have read, and like I said, there's multiple different stories out there, the FBI did confirm that the clothing, there was no DNA on the clothing. It was not even clothing. It was more like a burlap from a burlap bag, and it was not the clothing that Sherry was wearing on the day she disappeared. Now, as far as the photo is concerned, I have read stories that the FBI confirmed it was not a decomposing head. I have read stories that the FBI said they never received the photo. So we don't really know what the case is. And like I said, if you are interested in seeing this photo and seeing for yourself what you think it might be, It's all over the internet. Just Google Sherry's name, and I will list sources in the description box below from where I found this information anyway. So it'll be there as well. So like I said before, Raymond passed away. Her stepfather passed away back in 2003. I believe her mother is still alive, and she is still actively looking for information on as to what happened to her daughter. Sherry would be 49 years old if she is still out there, and I will leave a photo of what Sherry looked like at the time of her disappearance, as well as some age progression photos of what she may look like today. You can also find those on several of the websites. I will leave the phone number for the Greenville Police Department, who is still handling this case, as well as a phone number for the Center for Missing and Exploited Children, who you can contact on tips for any case, not just this one. So thank you guys so much for stopping by today, and I hope you have a great day. Bye.